SAFIRE as a astrophysical laboratory. I've spoken several times about how we might use the SAFIRE chamber to explore solar physics, planetary physics, cometary physics. And here's a list of some of the areas that we are gearing up for. I'm not going to describe all of these because that would take several hours. Coronal mass ejections off the sun, coronal streamers, structures inside the corona that have peculiar properties, the electrochemistry of comets, what kind of substances might be created if electrical forces are brought into cometary physics, temperatures in the corona of the sun, double layers. The exploration of double layers is just starting. It's so exciting. They're showing up everywhere you look. So we're in a beginning phase of double layer research now. Fast radio bursts, I haven't talked here about those, but another aspect of radio astronomy that's not very well explained. Ionization potential of elements, heliospheric boundary, ionospheric boundary. So that's about 30 or 40 years of research for the SAFIRE team. So hopefully we can get the ball rolling and then other people will join in into the fun. Now, one of the main objections to our program is that suggestions that you can't really replicate these things in a box, right? That suns and planets are too big, the vacuum of space is too strong, you're not going to be able to get meaningful results by studying this in a laboratory. And that's a reasonable challenge. When faced with deciding if something is possible or not, I don't usually look to equations first. I usually look to experiments, or I find somebody that tried it to ask if it's possible. So you could say actually anything is theoretically impossible until someone actually does it. So the things that other people have worked on are highlighted in red. Those have already been worked on in laboratories outside of SAFIRE. There's probably other work that's been done also. If anybody knows of any other labs that have done research into these other areas, by all means, contact me. We need all the input we can get. So SAFIRE is a tool. I want to put these. SAFIRE is a tool that we have to use with lots of other tools to understand how electricity manifests in the solar system. And to understand anything scientifically, there's usually a back and forth process that starts. Sometimes you look out into nature and see what nature's doing, and then you go back to your laboratory and you try to do the same thing. So that's kind of like from an outside in. But sometimes you do it the other way. You go to your laboratory, you observe phenomena, and then you go look for it outside in nature. So those are two very different directions for how one does science, and both directions are absolutely essential. That's how new paradigms come into being, is with both of those directions. Now, so far, the last several years when I've spoken, I've really only talked about from the outside in. That long list of phenomena that we're observing around us and trying to figure out, well, how can we replicate that in the lab? So today, I'm going to talk about the other direction. How do we take what we see in the lab and then go look for things out in the world around us? So what you're looking at here is a proposed shape for the electrical potential between the sun and the Earth, actually between any star and any planet, between the sun and the Earth. Now, you're not going to see this diagram in any astrophysical literature. The Earth over here, the sun over there, a lot of space in between here, leaving the sun, covering all the great reaches of space to the Earth. And this blue line is a proposal, an idea, a sketch for how the electrical potential looks between a star and a planet. As one moves away from the planet, a very steep rise of a lot of voltage that's wavy, goes up in steps, then a little bit of a drop-off, and then a slow rise over great distance back up to the star. Now, the number I put on here, I realize I didn't take spherical geometry into account, so this number is probably going to be more than 600. It's probably going to be 1,200. Who knows? Just this is a sketch. So why am I saying this, that it should look this way? Well, it's an educated guess from the, so far, the SAFIRE data. It's also based on about 100 years of plasma discharge experiments in laboratories. And this is also from me thinking about and digesting the work of Anthony Perret, Ralph Juergens, Walt Thornhill, Don Scott, etc. And so based upon all this data in the lab, I'm saying, let's go look for this. Let's go out and see if there's any data that supports it. So the first, on the here leaving the planet, that quick rise off of the planet, we actually do see that. There's plenty of data for that. It's called the Fairweather Potential. There's various explanations in the literature as to why that is there. Almost all of those explanations say that that big increase of voltage is caused by lightning on Earth, is the cause of that. And I am starting to think it's probably the other way around, that if anything, lightning is trying to dissipate that voltage, because that voltage is part of a larger picture of a planet's relationship to its star. So the model's doing pretty good so far. What about the squiggles? Why did I put those in there? I put those in there because in the laboratory, a large electrical potential change in plasmas almost always happens in steps. It doesn't go smoothly, it doesn't go all at once, it almost always goes in steps. So I put steps in there because that's what one sees in the laboratory. I'll just say a little bit more about that to give you a flavor. Let's say I have two places in space. Point A is at a high voltage, point B is at a low voltage. Okay, and then there's gonna be a connection between them. We're gonna fill it with plasma or something, put something in between those two. So you might first guess that the voltage would do something like that, but you hardly ever see that in nature. What you see sometimes is something more like this. There often will be a really quick change and then not much after that. But a lot of the time, what nature does is something more like this, because achieving that change in voltage in steps. Here are some, you've seen some of these, some of the pictures from SAFIRE. These are steps in voltage. The chamber is, you know, accommodating the difference between the center and the edge, accommodating that voltage change by putting it in steps. Okay, prior to the drawing the graph that you saw, that blue line graph, I knew very little bit about the ionosphere. I still know hardly anything about the ionosphere. It's a very complicated structure on our Earth. But I thought, well, if my model is predicting there should be steps of voltage change, let's go look for it. Do I have any data that I can turn to that says, yes, this happens in steps? So this is a picture that's often published in geophysical texts. The surface of the Earth is down here. You're going up, leaving the Earth by going up that way. Everything we know, right, is right down here, basically. And I want you to look at this red wavy line to the right here. That is a graph of the free electron density as you go away from the Earth. And as you can see, it doesn't increase smoothly. It increases in steps. Now, I read plenty of explanations for why the steps are there. Almost all of the explanations talk, again, about local causes, ignoring any kind of picture that would be placing the Earth in a larger environment where these would be expected. And one of the main attributes of most of the papers that describe it is how surprised everyone is by the steps. And then you have to go try to explain it because you're surprised by it. But you're only surprised when your model, when you have the wrong model, right? If your model is right, then you're not surprised by as many features. So coming back to this diagram, which I put in here for these steps because of phenomena I know in the lab, look out at nature, the amount of free charge is going up in steps. Now, is that exactly the same as what I'm describing, the ionosphere in the chambers? This is why we have to do the research, because no one's looking at this yet. So now we can have a model, we have a question, we can go back to data and explore it more. So let's keep going, right? So we did here, Now, what about this? Why did I put that in there? Well, I put that in there, again, because of studying phenomena in the laboratory. Now let's go out and look at nature and see if around the Earth there's anything like that. Well, there are these really strange structures around the Earth called the Van Allen belts. I knew a little bit about them before working with this model. In their simplest form, they are a couple of layers of charge in close to the Earth, a region that's dominated by positive charges, and then on the outside, regions that are dominated by negative charges. So on my blue drawing, I had a high point there. That would be right about here at the where the Van Allen belt has the most positive charge. And then it dropped off. That would be out here where the Van Allen belt, where the negative charge starts to increase. So what I just said is not accepted by any astrophysical journal. If you call up the radiation belt storm probe people at Johns Hopkins, like I did, and you ask them about this, I was told very calmly but insistently that, well, there can't be any charge separations in space, so no, you can't have positive and negative separate like that in the Van Allen belts. Okay, thank you. All right, so I went back to the data's all published, which is awesome. All the data from these satellites, if you want to analyze data, it's great. And so I went back to the raw data from the satellites with my question, because I was like, well, I still think the model might be right, right? And so there's satellites flying through these belts. They go out, and then they come in, and they go out, going into the inner belt, back out to the outer belt. Here is some data, sample data. There's about 7 hours on the horizontal axis here, about 7 hours of time passes by. The satellite is outside of the Van Allen belt, and then it comes inside into the inner belt, and then leaves the outer belt. So this interesting part here is when it's going from the outer belt into the inner one, and then back out. So this is electric field. Okay, electric field is not the same as electric potential. My plot has electric potential, right? But the two are connected. If you know the field, you can determine the potential and vice versa. An equation that connects them is this. It says that if you know the electric field everywhere or along a path, and then you multiply that electric field by every point in your path as you're traveling, and you add all that up, that'll give you the potential, the amount of potential change, which would give back to the plot that I drew. So I took the raw data of the electric field measurements from the satellite, integrated it through the orbit, and get a plot kind of like this. So as I'm coming into the Van Allen belt from far away, there's this interesting structure, don't know what that is, but there's an enormous change, increase in potential as you go into the inner belt. And this changes thousands of volts. So that pretty much says to me that the inner belt is at a much higher potential than the outer belt, which means that you have to have separated charges to maintain that. So coming back to the diagram. Lasso? Yeah. Again, this, as you come towards the Earth, from the outer belt going into the inner belt, arise up. That's going to be the highest point locally of the potential right there. So again, I want to recap, try to make this clear. What I just talked through is pretty amazing, okay? I sketched out a proposed graph for what we would see if we went out and looked at any data available for us. And I got this graph by looking at data in the laboratory, okay, and listening to people like Wall and Don and others. I didn't create this graph initially by looking at any NASA data. I didn't create it by reading any publications about electrical environment or between planets and stars. Okay, and I took that graph, and then I went to the literature and said, well, does the literature support my model? And I just talked through the ways in which it does. So we should keep going, right? Okay, what about this slow rise here? And anything we can find out about that? So if you stay up late nights reading instead of resting, then you might come across some amazing papers in the late 90s and early 2000s by Mangini and Salem. And they used data from the wind satellites, which had a very high time resolution for measuring electric fields. And they analyzed their data. So the wind satellite sits on my diagram somewhere about here. It's between the Earth and the Sun, I mean, in distance-wise, but it's away from the Earth. It's away from the immediate environment of the Earth. It's somewhere out in this area. And analyzing their data, they found that there is a continuous stream of double layers, electric double layers, coming from the Sun outward, all directions. Well, the satellite's only here, streaming past the satellite, traveling double layers. So to give you an image of what that might mean, these double layers are little changes in potential, of electrical potential, and they're streaming out from the Sun. So you could imagine maybe a stream out on the East Coast. We have these mountain streams that they don't go down one big fall like a Niagara, right? They go down rock by rock by rock by rock, little changes in height of the water. So a picture of something more like that, if you're standing on the Earth looking at the Sun, there's this stream of little increases in potential going all the way back to the Sun. And if you add all those up, as Mangini and Salem do, they get 600 volts difference between the Earth and the Sun. All those little increases, 600. I found out not too long ago, they didn't take spherical geometry into account for adding them up. So there will be more of an increase as you get closer to the Sun, just for geometric reasons. So again, this is pretty good stuff. This again was my picture here was drawn from lab data. Go find someone who's been measuring this stuff. Yeah, they have very much the same scope. So of course I put together data from a lot of different groups, a lot of different, you know, people consider themselves geophysicists who are studying this. People only know the Van Allen belts who are studying this, et cetera. But they can be all that can be brought together if you have the right model. Well, is there anything else we could predict? Well, something like this can give directions for looking at connections between structures that we know about. So these layers in the ionosphere, remember that red wavy line, quite variable. They're always changing. They're never staying the same, okay? Well, we should start looking at how they're changing relative to what the Van Allen belts are doing, because these changes have to be linked. And we can look and see what kind of changes are happening in this stream coming from the Sun. How is that affecting things? That's one direction we can go with this. And then what about what close to the Sun there, right? So I was thinking all about that, but Don answered all our questions the other day. So you can ask him about what's happening right there. So that's really it. That's my installment for this year. Thank you very much. I want to thank everybody who supported the SAFIRE project. Very exciting stuff. Thank you.